Hare Krishna. Welcome back to the narration of those 18 days. Today we are on the penultimate day, day 17, and today we discuss about the traumatic as well as puzzling fall of Karna. Karna was the arch rival of Arjuna, and Karna was the person in whom Duryodhana's confidence lay the most, because he believed that Karna shared his animosity toward the Pandavas. And from the 10th, 11th day onward, when Karna entered into the battlefield, everybody knew that practically the decisive battle in the war would be between Karna and Arjuna. And although they confronted each other on many occasions, they somehow were not like in a head-to-head confrontation for very long, brief skirmishes. On the 16th day, while Arjuna was engaged elsewhere, Karna wreaked havoc. On the 17th day, he also defeated and humiliated Yudhishthira. And then finally, the confrontation of Karna with Arjuna came about. So, as both of them approached each other, Karna turned toward his charioteer, Shalya, and asked him. Now, Shalya was himself a powerful warrior. He was a Maharathi, and he was also the elder relative of the Pandavas. Yet on Karna's special request to Duryodhana, Shalya had been designated as Karna's charioteer. And Karna turned to Shalya and asked him, what if I am killed today? He said, I will march against the Kauravas and against the Pandavas and try to destroy them, or I will meet him with a hero's death. Arjuna turned to Krishna on the other side and asked Krishna, O Keshava, if today Karna kills me, what will you do? Krishna replied in a thunderous voice, O Partha, the sun may fall down, the earth may shatter into a thousand pieces, water may stop flowing, but Karna will never be able to kill you. If somehow Karna does kill you, then the world's destruction will be at hand. Karna, Shalya, and the entire Kshatriya army will be destroyed by me. Hearing Krishna's words, Arjuna felt enlivened. Oh, Krishna, there is no doubt that I will be able to defeat Karna today. My greatest strength is that I have you by my side. With your guidance, I can defeat anyone. As the two warriors started contending against each other, they had a long history that flashed back in front of their eyes as they remembered the many occasions when they had contended or partially contended with each other. This was the battle that Karna had been waiting for. The first time Karna had seen Arjuna being lauded, praised, cheered in the martial exhibition in Dronacharya's Gurukul at the end of their education. Karna's heart had burned with envy. Why is Arjuna getting all this praise? I am as good, if not a better archer. And he had barged into that martial exhibition, which was meant for Drona students. He said, can I exhibit my skills? I can exceed everything that Partha has done. Just hearing that proclamation angered Arjuna, who grabbed his bow. He longed for an opportunity to crush the arrogance of this stranger. At that time, Karna exhibited his full archery skills. and he equaled everything that Arjuna did, but he couldn't exceed it. So then he asked, "Can I have a duel with him?" So at that time, because he was not a Kshatriya, he was not allowed to duel. Then Duryodhana gave him a kingdom, the Anga kingdom. He felt very indebted, and that became the start of a friendship that would eventually be extremely costly for him. Would cost him his morals, would cost him his family, and ultimately cost him his life. But at that time, he didn't see the costs, he saw the gains. And he gratefully accepted Duryodhana's offering of the kingdom and of his friendship. And then again, they were going to fight, but the sun set at that time, so the duel didn't happen. So that was like an engagement that was a draw between them. Then again, Karna, they never really fought one to one for a long time, but another encounter was in Drupada's daughters, Draupadi Swayamvar. Arjuna was dressed as a Brahmin, and the Kshatriyas attacked Arjuna, thinking that this Brahmana is stealing the princess who is meant for us. So at that time, Karna attacked Arjuna, and both of them fought, but Karna was not able to get an upper hand. So again, it was a draw at that time. If we keep score, it was 0-0. It was on both occasions. Now, prior to that, the Drupadas are after Drona's Gurukul education got over. Drona asked that Krishna, the Drona asked his students to defeat Drupada and bring him as a prisoner in front of him. So the Kauravas rushed forward with Karna by their side, and they were all defeated by Drupada. And then the Pandavas went, and the Pandavas defeated Drupada. So we could say this indirectly. Arjuna proved his superiority over Karna. Arjuna defeated the one who had defeated Karna. That was 1-0. Then again, in the battlefield, when the Pandavas were in exile, at that time, Duryodhana and Karna and others were attacked by the Gandharvas. So the Gandharvas defeated Karna, and Karna fled to save his life. And Duryodhana was arrested, and at Yudhishthira's request, Arjuna and Bhima came to help release Duryodhana. So Arjuna defeated the same Gandharva who had defeated Karna. It was 2-0. Then the again, we could say this was not a direct battle. Yes, there had been a direct battle also. That was at Virat. It was not just a direct battle between Karna and Arjuna. It was Arjuna fighting against the entire galaxy of Kaurava heroes. And Arjuna defeated all of them. The Karna tried to attack Arjuna twice, and on both occasions he was defeated. So some people say that Karna was much stronger than Arjuna, and Arjuna had to resort to unfair means to defeat him. Well, that doesn't match with the history of the Mahabharata. Thrice Arjuna defeated Karna, and never had Karna defeated Arjuna. So now they fought fiercely. So as they approached each other from both sides, warriors came to support them. So Duryodhana tried to bring as many warriors to intervene in Arjuna's path so that Arjuna would get distracted and exhausted. And then by the time he faced Karna, his energy would be lowered. Arjuna fiercely and forcefully shot such arrows at all the people assisting, people obstructing him and assisting Karna, that they all fell back. And soon it became a battle between these two great archers. As they matched each arrow that the other person sent, and as the battle went on and on and on, that time, as Arjuna had been approaching, Vrishasen, one of the sons of Karna, was attacking Bhima. Bhima had been defending the Pandava army and trying to attack the Kaurava army. And then Vrishasen turned toward Arjuna. Nakula came to assist Arjuna. So Vrishasen attacked Nakula. And Nakula got wounded. Vrishasen started roaring in joy. And Bhima said, "I can kill Vrishasen right now, but I will leave him for you." As Karna was fighting with other warriors and also watching right in front of Karna's eyes, Arjuna remembered how Karna had killed Abhimanyu. Arjuna shot arrows at Vrishasen. Vrishasen fought fiercely, but he was just no match for Karna. and sorry, he was no match for Arjuna. And right in front of Karna's eyes, his son was killed. Karna cried in lamentation. And then with fury, he attacked Arjuna. As their fight became more and more in dead earnest, sometimes it seemed that Arjuna had the upper hand. Sometimes it seemed that Karna was on the ascendant. But the battle went on and on. Such was the force of the battle that all other warriors fell back. The Kaurava army had been depleted to a very small fragment of what it had started with. Of course, the Pandava army had been also killed. There were warriors still fighting, but as both of them started using celestial weapons, those warriors fell back. Initially, Karna used his Bhargavastra, and the Astra came with such force. It destroyed hundreds and thousands of warriors and soldiers on the Pandava side. And seeing this destruction, Bhima called out to Arjuna. He said, "O Partha, how have you allowed such destruction to happen? Remember Abhimanyu's death, remember Draupadi's insult, and crush this son of Asutha." Arjuna was also chided by Krishna. He said, "Why are you letting Karna get the upper hand? This is not the time for weakness. You summon all the strength that you acquired by your archery expertise, by your austerities, by your acquisition of celestial weapons, and use it all to defeat Karna." Arjuna at that time invoked the Brahmastra and he destroyed vast amounts of the forces supporting Karna. And they called out to Karna, those who survived, "Please save us from Kunti's son." Incensed at seeing the destruction of the Kaurava forces, Karna shot fiercely at him. And as they started fighting forcefully, soon everybody fell back and they started watching. So, whereas celestials had always been watching from overhead, now others also started watching on the battlefield itself. Yudhishthir had been wounded earlier by Karna, but he returned. And seeing him return, everybody cheered on the Pandava side that he was healthy and recovered. So he also gathered and started watching. Everybody was astounded to see the skill of these two warriors. As they kept fighting, Karna realized that with simply a skill of archery, he would not win. Started thinking of the various celestial weapons that he had, which one could he use? He thought that if he could shoot a series of arrows at Arjuna and stun him, and then use a celestial weapon, then Arjuna would be too overwhelmed to counter that weapon and he might kill him. So, thinking thus, he shot a series of arrows at Arjuna so fast and so forceful that they pierced into Arjuna's armor, and Arjuna fell back, stunned. At that time, Karna thought of the Naga Astra. Actually, there was a Naga named Ashwasen, the son of Takshak. That is the snake bird who eventually bites and kills Parikshit Maharaj. So, this Ashwasen, he remembered how some of his family members, his mother and brother, had been killed by Arjuna while the Khandava forest had been burned. With that enmity in mind, he had been looking for an opportunity to kill Arjuna. So he entered into the Nagastra, which Karna was about to shoot. And as Karna thought about the Nagastra and looked behind, it seemed like the Nagastra seemed to leap out of his quiver and come into his hands. And he shot it. As that sped through the sky, it seemed to rip the whole firmament apart. It was like a blazing bolt of death. The observing warriors and the observing celestials gasped in amazement and fear. Arjuna, meanwhile, was too stunned to do anything. And Shalya, knowing Arjuna Karna's intention, told him, "Shoot the arrow at Karna's at Arjuna's chest. The idea is that if you shoot at the chest, if there is the arrow goes slightly off target, still it can hit the neck. If it goes above off target and if it goes below off target, it can hit the belly, and both can still be fatal. But Arjuna, but Karna didn't just want to win. He wanted to win with class. There is a certain class in, say, knocking off the head and having the head fly away, and it is like a smashing victory. It's like a batsman who's on, who wants to win a match, but he doesn't want to win the match by simply taking a single, but he wants to hit a smashing sixer. So Karna shot an arrow at Arjuna's neck, disregarding Shalya's advice. And Krishna recognized the danger that his devotee was in. And Krishna suddenly put his foot forcefully down on the chariot. And on the chariot side, the footrest. And he put his foot down so forcefully that the chariot sank into the ground. And along with that, Arjuna's level lowered. And the arrow that was meant to take off his head took off his diadem, his crown. And everybody celebrated and nodded, knowing that Krishna had saved Arjuna's life. Arjuna recovered. And at that time, Ashwasen went back to Karna and said, use me and you will be able to destroy Karna. You'll be able to destroy Arjuna. I'm Ashwasen. So Karna said, no, I will never use the same arrow again, and nor will I depend on anyone else's power for killing Karna. Go wherever you want for killing Arjuna. Go wherever you want. So Ashwasen decided to himself charge towards Arjuna, but Krishna had alerted Arjuna now about the particular weapon, and also Arjuna had recovered from the wounds inflicted by Karna, and he shot several forceful arrows in succession and ripped the snake weapon apart. As Karna kept fighting again and again, shooting arrows, Arjuna slowly but surely seemed to be getting the upper hand. Karna started feeling, he started despairing what to do. He started thinking that maybe I should summon the Bhargavastra. Just some time ago he had invoked it and it would make havoc. Now it could annihilate the Pandavas army. And as he tried to remember the mantras for the Bhargavastra, those mantras wouldn't come to his mind. He tried again and again, but those mantras just didn't come. And he remembered how he had been cursed by his preceptor, Parshuram. Karna had pretended to be a Brahmana while taking instruction from Parshuram. And when Parshuram had come to know that he was actually a Kshatriya, he said, whatever you have learned, at the time when you need it the most, you will forget it. He realized that his preceptor's words were coming true. In despair and anger, he started cursing destiny for thwarting him. At that time, he saw a ghostly looking dark form hovering near him. And he recognized it to be Kala, time personified. And that form said to Karna, see, your chariot is sinking into the ground. He looked and saw that, looked down and saw the wheel was going deep into the ground. Shalya was moving his chariot desperately, but he just couldn't get it out. As he observed, he tried to keep fighting, but an immobile chariot was a disadvantage. So he got off his chariot and he tried to pull it out. Now before that also, why was Karna despairing? Because Karna had been fighting, but Arjuna shot arrows with such force and fury that Karna was overcome. He was wounded and he was shaken. At that time, is with his armor pierced, his body bleeding, with his bow broken, with he not in his proper senses. Seeing him like that, Arjuna lowered his bow, waiting for Karna to recover. Krishna told Arjuna, why are you making such a mistake? He is a brutal enemy. He did not wait earlier while shooting the snake weapon toward you. Do not lose this opportunity to end the life of this wicked son of Suta. So, hearing those words, Arjuna started shooting his arrows. And Karna, realizing the danger he was in, somehow kept fighting back. But that's how he was despairing. And now his despair started increasing, for he felt that fate was conspiring against him. He got off his chariot and he tried to pull the chariot wheel out. He couldn't. Then he quickly jumped back on his chariot and started shooting again. He shot the Agniastra and it started wreaking havoc in the Kaurava Pandava camp. And Arjuna shot the Varunastra and countered that. Karna, wanting to gain some time, he shot arrows in such succession that they stunned Arjuna, and then he broke Arjuna's bow. But with lightning speed, Arjuna strung another bow. Now, this takes time. You take a bow and then string it and be ready to fight. Arjuna strung the bow, Karna broke it again. Arjuna strung another bow, Karna broke it again. And this happened 12 times. And Karna was stunned to see the speed with which Arjuna was stringing his bow and readying himself to fight. Nothing that he was doing seemed to be working. Again, he tried to shoot a series of arrows to stun Arjuna, and then he leapt off his chariot. Again, as he tried to pull his chariot up, it couldn't come up. So Arjuna lowered his bow. At that time, Karna turned toward Arjuna and he said, "Oh Arjuna, do not entertain the thoughts cherished by cowards. Remember the codes of virtue and wait till I am ready to fight." At that time, Krishna replied, "O Karna, fortunate indeed it is that today you remember the codes of virtue. Was it virtue that impelled you to kill Abhimanyu along single-handed and defenseless? Charioteless and weaponless, armorless and friendless, while you attacked him together with five other warriors? Did virtue not enter your mind when you saw Draupadi being dragged into the assembly? Was it virtue that made you suggest that let Draupadi be disrobed? Was it with virtue in mind that you told Draupadi, now find another husband? Where was your virtue when you conspired to have the Pandavas burned in the house of Lakh at Varnavat? Was it virtue by which you joined with Shakuni in laughing as you cheated Yudhishthira of his kingdom? Did you never consider virtue when Yudhishthira and the Pandavas, after living dutifully in exile for 13 years, asked for their rightful share of the kingdom and you scornfully rejected? If it was virtue at all those times, then Arjuna will summon that same virtue today." Karna had also in his earlier speech blamed destiny. He said, "It is my misfortune that because of destiny I am put in this helpless situation. Wait till I am ready to fight." So Krishna replied, addressing that point, he said that people often blame fate for their difficulties without remembering the wrongs that they have done themselves. So this is a critical point. Often Karna is seen as a greatly wronged hero. He was subjected to unfairness in life right from the beginning. He was born in a Kshatriya family, but he was not given the honor of a Kshatriya because his mother sent him away. And then throughout his life, he never really got the honor that he wanted. He faced so many unfair difficulties. Well, the Pandavas also suffered unfair difficulties. Although they were born in Kshatriya family, their father died when they were young. And they were persecuted by their own cousin, while their uncle, who was supposed to be like their surrogate father, watched on passively. while his own son tried to kill the Pandavas. So what wrong had the Pandavas done to deserve it? Bad things happen to everyone in the world. But point is not that destiny gives us bad situations, is that happens to everyone. Some people more, some people less. But it is that we make bad decisions also. So Karna was brought to this situation not by evil destiny, but by his own evil decisions. His decision to not only side with Duryodhan, but to stick with Duryodhan even when that person started doing horrendously evil things. Even if Karna had some virtue, he lost it because of his attachment to Duryodhan. He not only participated with, but instigated Duryodhan to some of his most heinous actions. The idea of disrobing Draupadi was suggested by Karna just to please Duryodhana. And thus, while he is a wronged hero in some ways, he's also a wrong hero. There is something heroic about him, but there is also something villainous about him. He supported a villain, and he himself became villainous in some ways in that association. So there are categorical ethics and there are contextual ethics. Categorical ethics is that this category is right, this category is wrong, and that's how it is. Contextual ethics is, yes, there are categories, but we also have to look at the context, look at the intent, look at the consequence, and then decide what is right and what is wrong. So Karna was calling for categorical ethics, and he was saying that a warrior should not shoot somebody who is not on a chariot, somebody who's not prepared. And that's true. That's the categorical code of war. But right at the start of the war, Dushyudhna had told the Kauravas that if you break the codes of war, then we will not hold ourselves back. So here, it was the Kauravas who had broken the code of war earlier. Abhimanyu had been chariotless, and Karna had not hesitated in shooting at Abhimanyu. Just a few moments earlier, when Krishna's saving Arjuna had caused Arjuna's chariot to go into the earth and be immobilized, at that time Arjuna had not asked Karna, "Stop, stop, my chariot is immobilized." He had kept fighting. So Arjuna was repaying Karna in his own coin. What Karna had done to Abhimanyu, what Karna had done to Arjuna, now Arjuna did to Karna. While Karna was on the ground trying to pull the chariot up, Arjuna picked up a powerful arrow, Anjali Kastra, and shot it straight aiming at Karna's head. As Arjuna shot that arrow, all the warriors on the battlefield froze. It seemed like the universe itself was stopping to watch this momentous occurrence. Arjuna's arrow sped through the air and lopped off Karna's head. His body, headless torso, fell to the ground as his head fell far away. Duryodhana's greatest ally was dead. The war was nearly over. Arjuna had emerged triumphant. The Pandavas celebrated. Krishna and Arjuna embraced each other, and thus they attained a great victory. Arjuna could have defeated Karna in a straight and fair fight as he had done earlier at Virat. But here, Arjuna wanted to act as Krishna wanted him to, and Krishna wanted to demonstrate a principle. But who shot him? With the cunning, sometimes you need to be cunning. And here, Karna was not doomed because life was unfair to him or that Arjuna was unfair with him. Karna was doomed because he was unfair to himself. He sacrificed his virtue for the sake of a person who was villainous, and thus he brought his death upon himself. Thank you. Hare Krishna.